Well, if you look carefully, you'll see subtle signs of decay throughout our society. Starbucks, for one example, recently announced that going forward, its seats and bathrooms will be open to non-paying customers. That's bad news if you want to bring your kids there. Pretty good news if you're a vagrant. Meanwhile, in New York, a couple had to evict their 30-year-old son from their basement because he refused to move out. Many defended his decision to live there forever. Mike Rowe is the host of the TBN show Somebody's Gotta Do It. The latest season of that will debut soon. He just spoke to us about these stories and how they may be connected. Here it is. Joining us tonight, Mike Rowe. Good to see you, Mike.
Tucker, how are you?
Couldn't be better, but bewildered, and maybe you can clear this up. Starbucks announcing you no longer have to buy anything to lounge around its stores or use the bathroom. Meanwhile, 30-year-olds are suing to stay in their parents' basements. Are these stories connected? Do they tell us something bigger about where the country is going?
Dogs and cats living together.
Exactly.
Look, I'm in the midst right now of doing what I do every year, which is try and give away work ethic scholarships. It gets harder every year. So,
it gets harder to give away money?
We've given away $5 million over the last 5 years. And yes, every year it gets increasingly difficult to affirmatively reward work ethic. There's some things my scholarship requires you to do that other scholarships don't. You have to write essays and make videos and sign a sweat pledge. And when people are often confronted with these hoops through which I ask them to leap, they take what you call umbrage at that, and I find it fascinating. It doesn't bother me so much because I understand that a valuable thing is almost always a thing that's in demand, and work ethic is very much in demand. But to answer your question, why is it harder to find it? I think that probably does have something to do with the expectations that have evolved out of the safe space movement, which you've done a lot to talk about on your program, and I'm starting to think that maybe there is a link between the expectations a patron might have in a Starbucks vis-a-vis the expectations a squatter who just happens to be genetically tied to you might have vis-a-vis the basement in which he currently dwells, et cetera, et cetera. You know, I mean, of all the divides in the country, I think you could probably make a pretty interesting case that there's a fissure running through the expectation of what happens when we elevate safety and feelings to a level of primacy. I think it creates a real disconnect that people are struggling to parse.
Well, wait a second. Are you saying that safety isn't the most important thing ever?
I'm saying that everybody wants to go home safe at the end of the day. Safety always would be a delightful bromide, a wise platitude. Safety first is the stuff of idiocy. It allows us to begin to believe that somebody other than us might care more about our well-being than we do. And the minute we buy into that nonsense, then we embrace the warm grip of complacency. So no, safety is not the enemy. But if you make it the priority, then let's just wrap ourselves in bubble pack and drive at speeds approaching 5 miles an hour and never assume anything that could ever be confused with risk.
That is really deep. When you say safety first, you're assuming, this is one of the many unarticulated assumptions that govern our society and no one ever examines them in the light of day, and you just did. So when you say, explain that a little bit more. When you say safety first, you're assuming that someone out there cares more about your well-being than you do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm saying that on dirty jobs, my crew and I sat through over 100 mandatory safety briefings. And through the first couple of seasons, they were very effective because we listened like this. We were very concerned. We were in a dangerous, hostile, unknown environment. But over time, the big safety first placards and the mandatory boxes that you have to check and the lockout tagout procedures, these things start to sound like the teacher in Charlie Brown, right? It's wah, 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 wah. And you stop listening. So the unintended consequence of telling you that nothing is more important than your safety is the very dynamic that leads people to walk across Fifth Avenue when the little man says walk, instead of looking both ways.
Exactly.
It's not a coincidence that the most dangerous intersections in the world are intersections that have signs that tell you when to walk. So again, we've talked about this with the minimum wage, we've talked about it with a lot of different things, but the unintended consequences of magnifying a virtue to a place it doesn't deserve to occupy will always come back to kick us in the throat.
Really deep. So are there safety briefings on your new show? You've got one of the biggest digital shows that's ever been. How much safety is in that show?
Well, safety, like I said, is always present in everything I've done. Dirty job, somebody's got to do it. Returning the favor. I mean, we always focus on going home in one piece. But part of doing that in my world is to say safety third. Now, that's controversial. That makes people go, what are you talking about? What's more important than safety? And now suddenly you're having a conversation about something that will ultimately redound to personal responsibility. Right. Safety third is just a way of cutting through the warm milk and the soft tissue that makes everybody comfortable. And when I say everybody, I mean actuarial accountants, I mean HR, I mean insurance adjusters. You've done it. How many times you got on a plane, you know, and been told by the pilot that the most important thing is to get you home in one piece? Just once, I'd like the pilot to say, hey, look, sit back and relax because I love my wife and my kids or my husband and my